like to introduce our slate of candidates and welcome you to meet the candidates tonight. I'm John DiLollo, along with Pam Dobos, Steve Husser, and Tom Majernik. We'll each in turn be introducing ourselves, telling you just a little bit about us. Each of us has a single point to make. We'll try to be brief on that, and then we're going to open the floor to discussions. Unlike some of the meetings you've been to, we just ask that when you come to the microphone, tell us what your first name is, so we're not calling you, hey, you. And that said, if we could all stand, put our hands over our hearts, face the American flag, and join me in the Pledge of Allegiance.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the Republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Please remain standing. I'd ask you all to join in a brief moment of silence in memory of those that were killed or severely injured today at the Boston Marathon. Thank you. Please be seated. Okay, who's number? Who's on first?
You have me there?
Sure.
As Mr. DiLollo said, we're going to just kind of start by each introducing, you know, who we are, why we're running, and then kind of after we each do that, we each have a brief, you know, thing to talk about, and we'll kind of go from there. You know, I know I think we're scheduled through 8:30. If it doesn't go that long, that's okay. If it does go that long or longer, I think that's okay too. So, but I'll start just by saying my name is Steve Husser. I've lived in Bethel Park nearly my whole life. I went to Bethel Park Public Schools from kindergarten through 12th grade and graduated from Bethel Park High School in 2002. I have a bachelor's degree in history and a master's in secondary social studies education. I went to the University of Pittsburgh for both of those programs. And for the past 3 years, I've worked as a training coordinator for a program that focuses on mentoring, tutoring, and service learning with at-risk Pittsburgh area youth. So that's just a little bit about me. You know, why I'm running, mainly I really just have a deep love and pride of this community and want to do what I can to serve the community and give back. You know, so that's a huge motivation. Just through my experience, through the work that I've done, through my education, I just absolutely believe and seen that education is the foundation of every community, and that you know, where there is strong education, there are strong communities, and I want to hopefully contribute to that. And I do believe that my, you know, educational experience, my personal experience and perspective can be valuable to the community and school district. So that's why I'm running. Mrs. Dobos, I think
okay.
You want to go next?
All right. My name is Pam Dobos. I'm a lifetime resident in Bethel Park. My husband and I graduated from Bethel in 1971. Is there a feedback?
Do you want to use this one?
Okay.
Not sure.
He had a dental residency, a dental practice here for 20 years. And he's now a full-time teacher down at Pitt. We raised our two children here, Michael and Erica, also graduated from Bethel Park. Both of my children were involved in the school's activities and in the programs. I also have a four-month-old granddaughter who will be in kindergarten in 5 years, which is one of the reasons I'm running. I was, for 35 years, an English teacher in the Bethel Park schools. I also am very active in my church, John McMillan Presbyterian Church. While I was a teacher of English, I taught just about every subject in every grade from 7th to 12th grade during those 35 years and sponsored many different activities. I was also a chairperson of the English department. And I'm proud of my career in the Bethel Park schools, and I think that that experience will be an asset as a school director. My husband and I have always been active in the community. I'm concerned about maintaining high standards for students, engaging them as critical thinkers, concerned about curriculum that is rigorous and flexible for our children, but which also fosters creativity within them. I've been concerned the last couple years about losing the quality of the educational standards that have been a cornerstone for us here in Bethel Park. Concerned about lowering the graduation requirements and eliminating programs or eliminating physical education requirements. We hope as a group to bring a positive attitude, one that will work amicably with the community, with the students, with the professional staff, and one that will put the students first and engage the community in decision making. Even though that sometimes that can be a messy process. I'm basically running for school director because I love this community.
My name is Tom Majerink. I'm probably the newest resident of Bethel Park. I actually grew up in Waynesburg, Pennsylvania, where I grew up on a working farm. So I honestly know the value of hard labor, early mornings, late nights, putting up hay, you know, just everything you can imagine on a farm. I got a degree in marketing from IUP, and I also got a degree in Spanish from IUP, and a BA and a BS. After that, I worked in the business field, and particularly in technology, for about 15 years, where I ended my career as an international business development director, and my territories included the Caribbean, Latin America, and Europe. The reason why I feel that is important is because while I was an international business director, I was responsible for negotiating many large contracts, business contracts, and had the opportunity to work in the negotiation process quite a bit. I moved with my family in 2005, and we moved to Bethel Park because of the school district. We've had friends who moved here right before us, and you know, we were just very pleased with what Bethel Park School District had to offer. Had I known all of this turmoil was going to happen right after we moved here, I may have had different thoughts. And I know I'm going to deviate from my comments a little bit, but I personally know two families who chose not to live in Bethel Park. They chose to live in other school districts because of the situation that's going on right now. So those are two solid tax-paying families we lost. And I'm sure there's more. These are just personal friends of mine. After a stint in business, I went back to school and got my master's degree at Duquesne in education, where from there, I began my career in teaching at Chartres Valley. Chartres Valley, I've taught Spanish. They have a K-12 program for language, Spanish. And since I've been there, I've taught Spanish from third grade up to eighth grade. Also, I've had the opportunity to teach their business courses, computer technology courses, Word, Excel, keyboarding, and so forth in the middle school. So I've had quite a bit of experience there at Chartres Valley, which I'm currently teaching right now. I believe that's it. I volunteer in the community. I love the community. I volunteered in basketball, soccer, t-ball, most of the sports for my kids. I have a daughter who's a junior, or stepdaughter who's a junior, a stepson who's at Pitt, first year in the engineering school. Wish he could be here to tell you what things he would change in Bethel Park and the values he sees from the program here. I think that's one thing that I would like to institute, some sort of communication with our alumni. But I have a son who's in kindergarten, and that's why I'm here. So, John?
Thanks. I'm Master Sergeant John DeLallo, United States Air Force Reserve retired. Too old to still be in the reserves. They throw you out at 60, they really do. It's crucial that you understand that I have no illusions of individually changing the climate that exists between the current board and several bargaining units by myself. So I'm here to ask for your vote tonight, as well as the vote for Pam, Tom, and Steve. And together, I believe our slate of candidates can make a true difference. I'm running on principle, not for a seat at the table, not for a title. And I want what everybody in this room wants, a quality education in a safe, secure environment. By insisting on a robust graduation requirement for our students, we can make certain that we attract the best and the brightest teachers and retain them. We also attract families moving into the community that not only wish to enjoy the fact that we're the 44th safest community over 25,000 people in the entire country, but that our curriculum is challenging and will prepare students for life after high school, be it in business, in universities, or other endeavors. I've spent 20 years in service to our nation, and before jetting off to all points of the compass, I lived in Bethel Park, moving here with my parents and our very large family in 1954. I'm back now after assignments in South America, Johnstown, Wichita, Kansas, Del Rio, Texas, Columbus, Ohio, and Southeast Asia, where I served in theater, but thankfully not in country, during the last waning months of the Vietnam War. I'm a life member of the Veterans of Foreign Wars and the Disabled American Veterans, and I still serve and support our veteran community. But more importantly, I bring to you 41 years of contract negotiation experience, both in the military, in aerospace, and in defense. After retiring from my last job, my wife and I relocated back to Bethel Park, and I'm happy we did so. It's a great community with even greater potential, and we enjoy our 5 grandkids. 2 of them attend Bethel Park schools. I'm deeply concerned about their future education, and I want to thank you in advance for your vote for the position of school director.
I know each of us are going to talk about kind of one point. At this point, like, I know there's a couple people in the back that are standing. I mean, feel free to come up and sit down. I don't want you guys to have to, there's definitely some seats throughout, you know, all the rows. I don't want you to have to stand all the whole meeting. So the kind of point that I want to start off with is kind of related to curriculum. And we certainly, one thing that's absolutely true is, you know, this district has had high standards for decades, for a long time, and has been a top district for decades. And we definitely want to continue and maintain those high standards. One of the many outstanding features of our district is the quality and amount of opportunity in both academic and extracurricular programs. It's obviously important to have top quality programs in the fundamental subjects of math and science and social studies and reading and writing. But we firmly believe that students must also have the chance to expand their minds and abilities in foreign languages, marketing, orchestra, band, chorus, theater, technology education, physical education, arts, sports, clubs, you know, etc. And we really want to do everything we can to protect all of these programs. We really believe that we must restore third grade strings, which was cut in 2011, and we must not lessen the amount of physical education for our high school students, which is being considered this year. There's also been a discussion, you know, over the past few months about lowering graduation requirements. One of the reasons given for lowering the graduation requirement is because it's negatively affecting students who are trying to fit Steele Center or electives at the high school like foreign language or band into their schedules, but can't do that. We really believe that we can increase the flexibility in the graduation requirements without lowering those requirements to address this problem. If students are given more elective options but still need the same amount of credits, we can maintain the graduation standards while also allowing students to pursue coursework that matches their abilities and interests. We also very strongly support the career and technical education programs in which our students can participate at Steele Center. We want to encourage more students at Bethel Park High School to take advantage of those programs. There's a great need for qualified workers in the fields of HVAC, automotive mechanics, cosmetology, and many other trades in our area, and really in America generally. One of the main functions of a school district is to get students ready for our futures. And we want students in Bethel Park to have the opportunity to acquire the skills and knowledge they need for careers in the trades. We understand the importance of technology to our society, and we know that it's vital that all students leave Bethel Park High School with high technological competence. But we think that technology should be used creatively and smartly in our district's classrooms. At the same time, we don't agree with increasing the use of technology just for the sake of increasing the use of technology. And we don't believe in approving every technological purchase just for the sake of having more technology. We have an abundance of creative teachers who deliver effective lessons in a variety of ways. Some lessons may involve a lot of technology, some may involve a little bit, some may involve none at all. And you know, we think all of those are fine as long as students are learning the material they will need to succeed. We know, final point, we know that we've lost some students in funding to outside cyber schools, and we'd like to increase the district's capability and flexibility when it comes to cyber school so that we can recoup some of those students and funds. And if any of you want to add anything to this, please feel free, but just kind of in summary, in general, our main aim is to improve upon and maintain the excellent curricular standards that Bethel Park School District is known for.
Thank you, Steve. Okay, one of the issues that the four of us have been talking about over the last few months is the issue of transparency. And as we witness and go to the school board meetings over the past several months, we are concerned about some of the things that we see going on. First of all, there's a lack of information available at the public meetings. The details of the meetings aren't distributed until 5 minutes before the meeting begins. Some of the information that is discussed isn't even available to the public. It's not in the public's hands. There are things that are referenced as packets of information that the school board has, but the community doesn't have that information. We think that those packets of information, the details, could easily be put on the website if printing is a concern about cost and so forth. But it could be on the website so that we could look it over before the meeting, given it a little bit of time. And then every discourse that you have with the school board is predicated on the Robert's Rules procedure. First of all, the public makes comments, then the board reacts to those comments, and that's it. So except through emails, the public doesn't have an opportunity to engage in any discussion with the board. And so then after this limited discourse, there's usually a 9-0 vote, and we wonder about that. We wonder about total agreement on every single issue that comes before the board, especially when there hasn't been very much opportunity for public exchange, discussion, town hall meetings.
I'd like to add something on it. Just recently, in a recent school board meeting, there was some discussion about a technology expense of $250,000. Now, in the previous school board meeting, we were told we're broke. We have no money. We can't do anything. Then they came out, the technology came out, showed some fancy slides. I have 30 years in technology, so his slides were pretty fancy for the average Joe. And the bottom line was they needed $250,000 to increase basically their data storage disk array system, hard drive in layman's terms. And I just felt that we needed more discussion. So I brought it up. I stood up at the meeting and said, I'd like to hear more information. What are the options? Let's hear, I'm the public, I'm the taxpayer. If you're gonna spend $250,000 of my dollars, tell me this is option A, this is option B, and this is option C. One option, let's not do anything now until we get our ducks in a row and we'll go from there. So I really truly felt that I had opened an avenue for some sort of discussion on the board. There was one brief comment made, and then it was voted 9-0 in favor of $250,000 worth of spending on basically data storage. Now, I can't see that. The guy may be an expert in technology, but I've got 30 years as well, and I know for a fact that that could have been put off 6 months, even a year. In the worst case scenario, things would get done, nothing would be lost. As he threatened, we'd lose data. That would not have happened. I guarantee it. I know how disk array systems work. He would not have lost any data. That's the type of thing that concerns me. There was no discussion, no back and forth discussion, and then a 9-0 vote. That was a lot of money considering the district's broke.
So we're hoping to change that communication. We believe there should be town hall community meetings where the community can engage in real conversation with the board. That the exchange of information, this exchange, this discussion, should extend to teachers, staff members, students, community business leaders, former alumni, so that we can use all of the valuable resources in the community, everybody, to help come to reasonable decisions. Alliances can be formed so that students can work with the community. We also think that detailed financial fiscal information should be easier for the public to access than it is right now. So we're hoping to change the negative climate to one of congeniality, cooperation, open discourse. We want to bring the positive back.
I've been asked to talk a little bit about contract situation, and I know that's a hotbed in this district. Currently, there's two outstanding contracts, and soon there may be four. I think the bottom line is this. This is all about our children. It's not about one side or the other. You know, for those teachers who are sitting out there, I'm a teacher. You know, it's not about the teachers winning. It's not about, you know, it's about the children. That's what it has to be about. What is in the best interest of the children? And that's what I feel that we will work towards. We understand that funds are finite, that they're predetermined. You can't change it. It's not like you can go to the Mac machine and get money out. It's there. Okay? This is how much we have to work with. Well, let's figure it out. Let's sit down at the table. We'll work within our community's means in a transparent manner. Transparency. We want the community, if you're a taxpayer, I want you to know what we're spending the money on. We want you to know what's going on with your tax dollars. Right now, I've been here for 6 years and I still don't know what's going on. And although I've been told, you know, come to the meetings and you'll find out, I've been going to almost all the meetings over the past couple years and I still don't know what's going on. It's sad. It really is. We will get involved. We will, if we're elected, we will get involved. Now, we've asked how many school board members have been in the negotiation sessions. And we've been given the runaround. Wouldn't that be a simple answer to have? How many school board members have actually physically attended any of the negotiation sessions? I don't have an answer. I'm assuming it's probably none. But I don't know, so I'm not trying to bait you. I'm just telling you what I know. And we have asked that question. Don't you think the school board members should be involved? Maybe after a year, let the solicitor take lead on it. But after a year, if it's not done, don't you think someone else should get involved? 2 years, 3 years, 1,000 days? I think it's time for the school board, hopefully us, to get involved. I'm not going to wave a magic wand and make everything fixed. But I promise you, if we get elected, we will be involved. We'll figure it out. Okay? Our children, grandchildren, are at risk. And I did mention before, I mean, I do have a degree in business and experience in negotiating contracts, as well as Mr. Delilah, many years with contracts. So we bring that to the table. Our focus is going to be on the immediate needs to benefit the children first. Again, keeps coming around to the children and the children. That's what I believe we need to focus on. That's why we're here. That's why the school board is there. It's got to be about the children. We'll hopefully repair the relationships that have been damaged over the years through the adversarial rhetoric and actions. And those are the relationships, I believe, with the different, unions, okay? And with the teachers' union, with the transportation union, with the other unions, we'll repair those relationships. We're not going to give in. We're not going to give away that's not the plan. The plan is to talk, to work something out. That's the plan. We want to rebuild the trust in the community. I think there's a lot of distrust right now between the community and the school board. And I think we're really going to work hard to rebuild that through some of the things that Mrs. Dobos mentioned we were going to plan on doing with those town hall meetings and so forth, getting other people involved. But the bottom line is we want to focus on Bethel Park School District by creating an educational environment that is positive and not only attracts the best families to our community, but also businesses. We want businesses here. We want businesses to come into the community. And trust me, I've heard they're not coming here because of the problems. I told you my own personal experience. Two people that I know personally chose not to. One went to South Fayette, one went to Peters.
Why? Because of turmoil in the school district. They didn't want to bring and subject their kids to all this. We want to try to fix that. So, and we want to be recognized as one of the best school districts, and we can't do it with all these problems going on. We need to fix it. So if I'm elected with our group here, I really promise to do as much as I can to fix all of that. We want to raise the bar, not lower it. So I think fixing those contract issues is going to help that. And Pam, may I just, on a side note, you mentioned about the website, how it's hard to find stuff. I always, all these school board meetings where there's so much going on and you guys might hear about it, wouldn't it be great if you could see what happened in the school board meeting without having to videotape, DVR it, or try to find it on the local channel? Well, there is a place on the school board website for videos, okay? And talk about saving disk space. The latest videos there are from 2008 and 2010. So why don't we delete those old videos and put our current school board meetings up there, and we'll see what happens. Your eyes will be opened. So thank you again, and I really hope we get your vote, and not just your vote, but your support, because we're going to need a lot of support here. Thank you.
Okay. Please do.
Please do.
I just kind of want to add something to kind of what Mr. Majerik is talking about in terms of contracts and relationship with teachers. And I mean, as we've all presented, we all, you know, Mr. Majerik is a teacher, Mrs. Dovis is was a teacher at Bethel Park for 35 years. You know, I have an education background. Mr. DeLallo, his son, is a teacher in the district. And, you know, I think there's definitely been people, you know, on both sides, you know, I think there's this kind of almost this teacher versus administration board mentality in the community, which I, you know, I understand. I don't expect everyone to, you know, sit and hold hands and sing kumbaya all the time. But, you know, that's, to me, everyone, administrators, teachers, board members, everyone is working together in the best to provide the best interests, to provide the best education for our students, and to do what's best for our community. That's what all of us want. And it shouldn't be this, you know, one side versus the other, this incredibly adversarial thing. I mean, I understand there's going to be the issues involved in all these are people's livelihoods, and it's going to be very personal and very emotional. That's very understandable, and I get that. But and there's going to be legitimate disagreement and debate and discussion. That's great. That should exist. But I think that can be done in a way where it's not like it's one side fighting against the other. And I think that's kind of what we want to do. And I mean, like I said, I don't think it's as simple and as black as white as you're either for the teachers or against the teachers. And you know, the four of us, like I said, there might be people in the community that just kind of see our backgrounds and say, oh, they're just going to give in and do whatever the union wants them to do. And that's just simply not true. I mean, I think we all have high respect for teachers. We also have really high respect for what board members do and what administrators do. And anyone who's doing good things in education, I have just the utmost respect for. That to me is the most important function of anyone in society. Anyone who's doing good things in education is just a hero in my mind. And so it's not going to be as simple as, you know, just because we have teaching backgrounds and connections to teachers, that's our top priority. We want to support teachers, we want to engage teachers, and we want to engage administrators and board members, but our top priority is doing what's best for the students and doing what's best for the community. So I just kind of wanted to add that and say that.
Yeah, and I wanted to piggyback on Tom's comments as well. You have heard me at the school board meeting several times make the comment, negotiations are easy. Negotiations are easy. Negotiating is easy. Maybe it's not quite that easy. After 41 years of Excedrin headaches, I can tell you that sometimes negotiations can be a little tough. But one thing's for sure. In order to be an effective negotiator, you have to be there. You cannot negotiate by remote control through your solicitor. Doesn't work now, hasn't ever worked, won't ever work in the future. And I'm going to echo what Tom said. Put us on the school directors. We will be involved in each negotiation session in order to rapidly resolve issues with our bus drivers, with our teachers, and with the upcoming contracts that are expiring with our secretaries and with our aides. Unless you would prefer to have four bargaining units out at the same time. But my subject, lucky me, I drew the short straw. So I get to address the issue of taxes. Now, I don't want to see my taxes raised. But I do recognize that for every dollar we spend on education, the value of our properties increases. Taxes, very sadly, are a fact of life. I will pledge to you as a school director and the rest of us as school directors that we'll hold the line on tax increases by questioning every purchase, every pencil, every piece of equipment. That $250,000 contract that was purchased, rather, that was approved for some Dell equipment, and I believe it's all hardware. Correct me if I'm wrong, Tom.
I believe it was mostly.
There's some training, but it was a significant purchase of hardware. And at the last school board meeting, I implored the school directors to please get another set of eyes, make sure that equipment is compatible with equipment that we have now. Make sure we need it. You know, given the opportunity, I would much rather have driven here this evening in a Rolls Royce with a gold-plated bathroom in it, but I came in my Chevrolet. It got me here. We're going to ask for austerity and careful thought given to every penny that the district spends. Are your taxes going to increase? Without question. As stewards of your money, your tax dollars, we are bound to do what we can to continue to make Bethel Park affordable, but without diminishing high standards. I don't think there's anybody in this room who wants to see what happened to property values in some northern suburbs happen here. If I stood before you tonight and pledged no new taxes, you'd tar and feather me and run me out of town on a rail, because you know I'd be lying to you. And if I stood before you and told you that we as a slate of candidates were going to spend like drunken sailors, well, quite frankly, that would be an affront to drunken sailors, some of my dearest friends in life, I might point out. Thank you very much. And unless somebody wants to add a little something on taxes on the dais.
Somebody told me once about taxes that if, you know, there's a lot of residents who don't have students in the school district, and I appreciate that. It was 75%, I'm not sure what the exact number is. But obviously no one wants to see their taxes go up. But if you don't fix the problem now, then people are going to move out of Bethel Park. You're going to lose those two families that would have moved to Bethel Park, and your taxes are going to go up dramatically because there's not going to be enough of a tax base because you're going to be losing businesses and residents. So, again, we need to fix this so we don't pay more taxes.
Okay. All right, we're going to open the floor up now. And for those of you who got here just a little bit late, I had mentioned this before. When you come up to the microphone, it's right here. We really don't need a resume. First name is fine, just so we don't call you "Hey, you." Some of the faces out there are familiar to us, and some of you, I'm sure, we'll get to know better as things go on. So at this time, the slate would be more than happy to field questions from the floor. So who wants to be the poor guy or gal that goes first?
We answered all of your questions.
Wow. Were we that good? Come on. Okay, we've got a willing volunteer.
This one?
Yeah, that's the one.
Hi, I'm Kelly.
Hi, Kelly.
I've seen most of you at school board meetings. I did like what you had to say about transparency. I think that there does need to be a little more. When you have questions, they're usually not answered very well. But I'm a little more interested in some details, and I don't know if you'd be able to address those.
Steve, I think you talked about electives, and if you keep the graduation requirements the same, but you want to encourage electives, how would you go about doing that?
Wait, so, I mean, right now I believe it's 27.
Is 27, yes.
27.
Should I sit back down?
Do you have any other?
Lots of questions.
Okay.
But other people have
it. It's up to you. So, in terms of the details, the way that I look at it, right now, there's 27, required credits, and they're within certain subject areas, there are specific amount of requirements. Right now, I believe you have to have 4 credits in each of social studies, English, math, science, and math. And then there's phys ed requirement. I don't know offhand all that, every list of every subject and what the requirement is. My thought on how, one of the issues that's been raised is, Steele Center students aren't getting enough credits, and so they have to, their schedule's inconvenience, just they're discouraged from going to Steele Center, or, my son or daughter can't take, French 5 because, she has to take this 4th year of science. And so my thought on how that you could, again, maintain that 27 credits so that kids are getting, a wide range of classes, but address those problems is to lessen some of those specific requirements in science and math, for example, so that and turn those into elective credits so that that student can take French 5 instead of Calculus 1 or whatever for the 4th year of math classes. I mean, I don't want to diminish any of the core subjects, but I also want to recognize that not every student is going to benefit. They might benefit from another class instead of a 4th year of science or math or whatever the case may be. So I think increasing that flexibility. And then, with the Steele Center thing, I think I would want to look at, what are the options that we can do in terms of giving them more credit for that, or because we absolutely don't want to inconvenience them, or because that's, I think, an incredibly important opportunity for students to have, and we don't want them to not be able. So does anyone else want to add something?
Yeah, also, reducing the number of credits will allow students to graduate early or to not take courses, to take study halls instead. But to keep the required number of credits, but just allow them to be more flexible with what they do. In other words, keep how many credits you have to have, but allow some flexibility in what you're taking is what we're advocating. So that the students are staying in school, so that they're not taking study halls, so that when they graduate from Bethel, they'll have the best education, whether they're going to a 4-year college, whether they're going to a trade school, or whether they're going right out into the work world.
Yeah. One of the key points was brought up at the beginning of this discussion when they were talking about lowering the graduation requirements was career exploration. I'm all in favor of that because I've got a junior at the high school and she's still not sure what she wants to do, and we've done some career exploration. But she's taken some elective courses that have kind of guided her where she wants to go. So my idea is, if the idea behind lowering the graduation credits is to allow students more flexibility to do career exploration, let's do it in an environment where we can monitor it and protect them, so they're not graduating in January and playing PlayStation for 4 months. Because unfortunately, I think if you allowed a kid to graduate early, a great majority of them probably wouldn't use that time effectively. I know, I've got 2 teenagers, so I'm speaking from experience. Maybe I'm just, I don't see the real world, but that's the way I feel. So let's give them that career exploration, but where we can monitor it.
We're also very concerned about the reduction in the physical education requirement from 4 years to 2, or from 4 semesters to 2 semesters, especially in this day and age where obesity is such a problem with our young people. And it's so important to teach them lifelong exercise habits at this point in their life.
Did that answer your question?
Yes.
Okay. We don't have a timer. We don't have a timer, and we don't have an incredibly large crowd, so we're going to give you a good deal of latitude. I'm not going to sit here and, you know, throw my water bottle at you at exactly, you know, 1 minute and 59. So do you have something else that you'd like?
I'll ask you one.
Sure, fire away.
I have been to multiple school board meetings. I am lucky to be on the PTO council, which means I get to meet once a month with administrators, with principals, with other PTOs, and with a school board member. And so in those meetings, there is a lot more transparency. But from my recollection, 72% of Bethel Park School's budget is spent on salaries, pensions, and benefits for all, not just teachers, but for all. That leaves very little wiggle room for anything else. And I'm pretty sure that's the number I remember, and I thought I looked it up. But you talk about putting the strings program back, and that would entail money. And you talk about being fiscally responsible, but where is it going to come from? Do you have any ideas yet, or is that, you know, when you see the line items?
I think the problem, we haven't seen a whole lot, at least. So it's kind of hard I promise when we get in there, we will definitely take a look at it and figure out, you know, where we can cut or make adjustments. And I know it's 75% of the budget goes towards salary. But you know what? So does almost every other school district. Chartiers Valley, as an example, I speak to that because I work there. Now, since I've been at Chartiers Valley for 9 years, I have signed 3 teacher contracts as a teacher. In that same amount of time, there's been one, I believe, in Bethel Park.
Well, what then is such the big difference between their contract and our contract?
That's what we don't know, obviously, because we're not privy to that information. Okay. But I know that when we get in there, we'll do our best to resolve it.
Now, don't forget the last best offer that's on the website right now. That's 13 months old.
Yes.
We have no clue, none, as to what the teachers have offered, or vice versa, what the school directors have offered. So, speaking to the relative merits of the terms of any prospective contract is pretty futile. But I just happened to keep a copy of the draft 7 budget, and more to your question, salaries and benefits. Salaries will be $37,538,217. Benefits $19,701 with $417. So you are looking at a total budget of $76,321,351. And we've got, what, $56 million in salaries and benefits. And that is not, I assure you, is not unlike many other of the school districts near us. And since I'm the guy that got the short straw, I guess I'll do the taxes. Again, salaries, $37,538,217. We have 17 Act 93 administrators, 4 other administrators, 6 supervisors, 376 teachers, 116 full and part-time paraprofessionals, 79 bus drivers, aides, and mechanics, 59 head and union custodians and maintenance, 33 confidential and building clerical staff, 9 technicians, 7 security guards, 3 of whom are full-time and 4 of whom are part-time. That's a considerable payroll. And from that, in addition to that $37.5 million in salaries, again, you're at nearly $20 million in benefits. And if you didn't get a copy, I'm sure, this is mine, and you can't have it, but I'm sure they have a copy of this that you can pick up at the admin building. And this is draft 7 for the 2013-2014 general fund budget for Bethel Park School District.
But also to address your question about what will we do, one thing we have agreed on is that we won't spend money until we get some of these problems. We have to figure out these problems first. We have to figure out four contracts. You know, if salaries are that big and benefits, we need to stop spending money. We'll survive if we stop spending money and figure out how to put our house in order. And that's one thing that we've agreed on.
Yeah, can I just add one more thing to that? So, I mean, some of the, I mean, in the budget presentation, there's some numbers about, you know, increasing healthcare costs, increasing retirement costs that are, it's dramatic and substantial. And that's, I understand how tough of a position the district and the board is in related to that. I mean, that's huge. And I mean, I think part of that, you know, all of us who care about public education here need to be contacting our state representatives about addressing those issues for sure. And if you asked about students, what are some specific things? You know, I talked about technology, you know, and when I talked about curriculum and how, you know, absolutely we know technology is vital and that students need to be good with technology. But I do feel like over the past couple of years that there have been some technology purchases that have not been necessary. Does it add up? You know, is it the amounts of those? Is it offset all those other costs? I mean, that's hard to say without seeing all the specifics of what different things within the contract would affect. But there, I know in December of 2011, a new cart of Mac computers was given to the high school, the brand new high school. It would cost over $100,000. That high school is overflowing with new technology. And that to me was something really, I didn't understand why that purchase was made. Mr. Majernik talked extensively about the data backup storage. Those were both, I think, from the general fund. There was a technology, I know, purchase within the last year or so, purchasing three big screen TVs for the high school for $18,000. I think that was coming out of the construction fund, but again, it's all money that's being spent. You know, those kind of things. You know, and I think the board talked about how that's going to help with the students developing video and stuff. But to me, really looking at some of those technology books, and by no means am I anti-technology, but we have so much already, and there are other ways. I do think that's an area where more discussions we have and where cuts could be made.
Because you two are actually full-time employees, would you be able to take days off to attend negotiation sessions?
I mean, I'm limited in how much time I can take off.
I have a certain number of days off that I certainly want to, and I actually have built up a lot because over the last 3 years, you know, I'm not in a position where there's certain days where I can't take off, but I want to be as engaged and involved, and I absolutely will have no problem using vacation days or personal days to attend, you know, to be more engaged. So,
but the idea isn't that all four of us, at least one of us, needs to attend to communicate to the others. I mean, to my knowledge, that doesn't exist now.
And the negotiators for the Federation of Teachers, don't forget, in the middle of the day, they're teaching. So typically negotiations are after hours. Now, you can have any time you want for me because I'm retired and loving it. But for those people who have a full-time job, I don't think that's going to be an issue. Okay, well, I promised that we weren't going to keep you on a short leash.
I'm absolutely fine with that.
But gentlemen, we actually have somebody standing up and volunteering to speak.
Yes.
Hi, how are you?
Hello.
And you are?
My name is Dean.
Dean?
Yes.
Thank you.
Lived in Bethel for 15 years. My first question is, you mentioned two families that didn't move to Bethel Park.
Yes.
Do you have statistics on overall real estate numbers of people that may have not moved to Bethel Park or on a drop in population in Bethel Park?
Absolutely not. I do not.
Okay, so the two families is just, I mean, those are people that you know, but it may not necessarily be reflective of whether people move here or not, correct?
But it could also, could be reflective.
Well, it could, but it's your personal experience.
And that's what I said it was.
But it's not necessarily a fact. We don't know for sure, correct?
I just gave you, this is a situation that I've come across.
Okay. Third grade strings. My son is in the orchestra in the high school. And I have a music background. I played music my whole life. My brothers play music, my grandfather, everybody in my family is a musician. I'm not so sure, why do you think third grade strings is so vital to bring back? Because to me, if I want my son to learn an instrument early on, I'll pay for lessons. You know, I don't necessarily look to my school district to provide that service. Of course, certainly you want orchestra, you know, you want a high-class orchestra, you want the band to be first class, understand, but it not, maybe not necessarily that early if parents, or it could be something like a how they do in the early foreign language with a rotation, and then maybe, you know, in one quarter you play something, the next quarter you play something else, so kids learn what they might be good at, or what they have a natural skill for. So why is it so important to bring third grade strings back?
So one thing that I've, my understanding of one of the reasons why orchestra started in third grade and band started in fourth grade is because, you know, elementary age students, the band is kind of, it's kind of flashier. It's kind of, more students are naturally attracted to that. And then they kind of wanted to give orchestra that heads up, that kind of extra year where, you know, it's not possible for a student to be able to enter, you know, the band. They have to, if they want to get involved in you know, the formal music playing, they have to do it in third grade in orchestra. And, you know, taking away that advantage for strings, I think in the long, you know, we're not going to see, if third grade strings doesn't come back, you know, we're not going to see the impact right now because it's been inactive for 2 years, it's been two classes, you know. But I think long term, you're going to see less participation in orchestra and less, just less interest in it and just less, you know, quality. So that to me was one of the main reasons. And then just in general of you know, you talk about getting private lessons. I don't know that every parent in the community can afford to get private lessons if they want, you know, if they want their student to participate in strings too. So just to give them that opportunity, you know, in the public school setting as well. Mm-hmm.
In terms of technology, working in the television field, I might have to disagree. I think that in any case, a data backup can fail because I've seen it at our station. But in terms of technology, I mean, it does sound like it's not the highest priority among the four of you. I kind of question that because to me, and now granted, I give you that you don't want to just spend the technology because you can. But I think that it needs to be a higher priority because in my opinion, and I've seen this in the professional world, if you don't keep up, you get left behind. So how would you reconcile that in terms of it being a priority?
I don't want to speak for everyone here, but I think I've been speaking a lot here, but I just to quickly say, like, this might be an area where we respectfully disagree. I don't minimize technology. I don't think it should have no role. I do think it's incredibly important, but we have so much right now, and to me, great education isn't. I've seen so many great lessons where kids learn so much that don't. It's the quality of the lesson plan, the creativity of our teachers. To me, that's more important than anything else in terms of giving quality instruction, and that to me, making sure kids get an outstanding, you know, have teachers that are creative and innovative, whether it's with technology or without technology, and that are passionate about what they do, that to me is the high, you know, if they can use technology effectively, that's excellent. But I think that might be an area where it might not be the same level of priority for us. To me, it might be slightly lower than you would put it, but I don't want to speak for everyone.
Well, I'll interject a comment. Dean, I did a lot of work with DARPA in my term of service with the Air Force. And I also work with the nuclear weapons delivery systems. As you might imagine, I was exposed to a little bit of technology. I think with technology, I mean, I used a slide rule when I was in high school. I wouldn't know what to do with it today. I'd much rather use a calculator. But the point that I think we were trying to make was, there was a very fancy PowerPoint presentation and a $250,000 spend that just blew through like the wind. And I really would have liked to heard a few more questions about that. You know, is it truly necessary? I'm not telling you that, okay, we're going back to stones and chisels and hammers and is it abacuses or abaci? Yeah. I don't propose to do that. But as I said, if elected, the slate that you have before you is going to question the purchase of pencils. If you heard me at one of my little rants at the school board meeting, I made the comment that during the Apollo program, the United States of America spent hundreds of thousands of dollars to develop a pen that will write in zero gravity. You can still buy it today. It's called the Fisher Space Pen. The Russians took a pencil. So technology, simply for the sake of being able to look at the guys over at Upper St. Clair and say, did I say Uppity St. Clair? I think I did. I'm sorry if I insulted anybody. I think I'm in a friendly crowd here. But seriously, technology simply for the sake of buying more technology, not on my watch, not on our watch.
And that was the point. All that I was asking, and of course there's no communication between the, like if I ask a question on the school board, they don't answer. I talk, they talk. That's the way, but my point before was that, what are the options? Give me option A, B, and C, and what if we do nothing? What's the worst case scenario? And yes, Mr. Means did bring up a brief point, okay? I thought we had a chance at that point. And just to table it, just to look at it a little bit more, a little bit deeper, the school board asked the public, and I believe it was Mr. Spicuzza who actually mentioned this, bring us your answers. You're the experts, or not you're the experts, but there are experts out there and sitting out there. Bring us help. We're asking you, the public, for help. And when I did that, I got shot down. So do they really want our help? They voted 9-0 on that. I mean, make it look good. Do 4-5, you know? So again, technology is great, but and I've been in technology since 8-inch floppy disks and Commodore 64. So technology for the sake of technology isn't the right. And now I'm in teaching, so I kind of see both sides. I sold anything from PC software, hardware, to mainframe, channel extension. I mean, I'm pretty familiar with it. But to have it just to have it isn't the answer. We put TVs in our classrooms about 10 years ago. Or actually 9 years ago, when I started CV, they put these great big TVs mm-hmm. mounted up there. Guess what they're doing this summer? Taking them out. Okay, so. Mm-hmm.
Yeah, I've as a teacher, I saw a lot of I shouldn't say a lot, but I saw waste in regard to technology, in regard to purchases that weren't needed, required, asked for, that just went to waste. And so that's where we're sort of looking very carefully. You know, technology can be great, but sometimes it's smoke and mirrors and bells and whistles, and it can be used, and there could be a poor quality product as a result of using it, where possibly if you didn't use it, maybe the content would be looked at a little bit more carefully rather than the flashy lights and so forth.
Mm-hmm. Okay, I have one more question, then I'll let you go. So you've obviously recognized that it's a concern, and so you've addressed it already a little bit in terms of negotiations with teachers that, you know, you're currently a teacher, which is an AFT union, you've had 35 years, and you have a son who's a teacher.
Right.
So you want to be involved directly in the negotiations. How do you resolve showing, I guess, the community where they might have concerns that you might be pro-teacher or pro-union? How do you go about resolving it within yourself that you're on this, essentially the school board side of things now, in terms of perhaps convincing a union to make concessions?
Well, I'll speak to that first, since it was I'm a parent and a taxpayer first. What I do in my job is that I drive out of the district. I am not a teacher in this district, so that has nothing to do with it. Okay, so the fact that I am a teacher and I have my feet in the, you know, on the ground with kids, I think is a huge benefit. I think it is, because I bring something different to the table. Okay,
I can't make a decision on my own. I can't make a choice on my own. You know that. It's you know, it's mm-hmm. negotiation. There's too many people involved. So I'm not in favor of one side or the other. I want resolution for the children. That's the point. Take that, I mean, the fact that I pay to the AFT, that's out the door. I'm a parent first. That's number one for me. My kids are number one. That's how I will differentiate between being a union member and a school board director.
Yeah, the Free Public School Act of 1834. I'm not that old. I looked this up. I really did. Establishes school directors, school boards, and their responsibilities. And I touched on it briefly, but let me make sure that one word sticks in your head. Stewardship. Stewardship. It's your money. It's my money. It's everybody up here's money. It's everybody in the district's money. It's not our money to simply give it away. Because I don't know what's on the table from the American Federation of Teachers or Bethel Park Teachers, local, or whichever the name of the correct name of the bargaining unit is, I can't give you an intelligent answer and tell you, absolutely, we're just going to sign off on that contract and get a vote and hopefully get at least a 5-4 and, you know, get things moving along. There may be elements of that proposal from the teachers' union that are absurd. There may be elements that the current slate of school directors are trying to insert into the contract that may be absurd. But because we have no dialogue, and we're going to fix that with town hall meetings. It won't be a monthly deal, but I guarantee you, a couple of times a year, we'll find a place, might be right here, where our council's been kind enough to offer this as a community resource. And we're going to talk to people. And we're going to get your thoughts. We're going to get teachers' thoughts. We're going to get administrators' thoughts. I'm personally just dreadfully tired of the unknown. It's the negotiator in me. How can I know and make an informed decision as to how good or how bad a contract proposal is unless I've got it right here in black and white where I can see it? And the most current information, like I said, is 13 months old, I think I'm pretty close on that. So I doubt seriously that there's been no negotiations in the last 13 months. Certainly there has to have been some conversation. In fact, I think there was a letter published by the president of the school board indicating there were some 55 negotiation sessions. Which takes me back to, well, fine, how many were you at? Not you personally, but you know, how many did you attend? You know, how much do you know? Or better yet, why aren't you telling us or giving us some snippets? I mean, you know, negotiating in public, someone at one of the school board meetings got up and said, let's get everybody, parents, educators, students that are of voting age, let's get everybody in a room and negotiate it in public. That's not going to work. That there are certain elements of the negotiation that you very likely will find out about when the contract is signed. But you have to trust that the people that you're voting into office practice stewardship.
First of all, I'm a lifetime member of this community. I'm also a 35-year teacher in Bethel Park school system. And I've been through lots of contract situations with the district. And my main concern in running for school board is that for too many years, there has been a lack of discourse, there's been too much conflict. between the community, the school, the school board, and the teachers. And other districts get it done, and they get it done with respect. They both respect one another. Other districts, teachers, for example, St. Clair, agree to some concessions. They have a good relationship. I think that any negotiation is built on a good relationship, and that's what I haven't seen in all of these years, and that's what I'm about, is developing a good relationship. One that's fair to the community, one that's even more fair to the students, one that's fair to the teachers also.
Thank you for your time.
Just to kind of follow up on that question too, I mean, I know I'm not currently actively in a union or have any relationship in the union, but I mean, I will, first of all, the final deal is voted on in public. So, I mean, that's one means of accountability that, you know, if when a contract is finally, comes to, my board members have to vote on that in public. So there's the accountability there. I mean, if you think that anyone is giving in too much to one side or the other, you know, they have to answer that with how they vote. I will tell you right now, I'll say this publicly, I'll say it privately to anyone. I've looked at, as Mr. Lyle said, there hasn't been a lot of, public information on negotiations. I think the last couple of things I've read over were, I think one was from like July or August of 2011. That was like the last best offer by each side, I believe. And then about a year ago, April 2012, there was a fact-finding report that kind of presented the areas of disagreement where each side stood. I've read over those, and I will say this publicly to anyone, whether regardless of side or not, there need to be concessions on both sides. I mean, the rising benefit costs. I will absolutely say, I believe, and I don't know where teachers are in the board in the district have negotiated what concessions they've given, but the teachers are going to have to do more contributions to benefits, and that the costs are just too much. So I will say that public out. There's other issues, specific issues where I think teachers need to get in. There's specific issues where I think the board needs to get in. So I don't know if that gives you any assurance, but I have no problem saying that publicly or privately to anyone that I've talked to. So.
Okay.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thanks, Lee.
My name is Richard Kraft, 102 Highland Road, Bethel Park. Lived in Bethel for more than 53 years now. Paid taxes all that time. Never had any children, so I've been paying teachers for a long time. It sounds like you're coming in with the premise of just starting over again, square one, and raise taxes. If that's the case, we could have done that 1,000 days ago. You know what I mean? I'm sorry I didn't get your name, but I'm sure you hear me out.
Well, my name's John, Rich.
Yeah, John.
Or is it Richard? I'm sorry.
That's right.
Richard. And since I drew that short straw and I get to talk about taxes, in draft 7, the millage increase is, and this is not candidates, this is the current school directors, and the millage increase is going up. Your taxes are going up in 2014.
I figured that, but try to keep them as low as you can, right?
Yes.
Well, again, by carefully questioning.
I'm not talking counting pencils. That's kind of ridiculous. That's going back to zero. These folks, the present board, been in their 1,000 days. They try to negotiate with the school, with the teachers. You sound like you're saying they never meet. I don't believe that's true. I think they try to get this across to you folks a long, long time ago. Otherwise, it'd be settled by now. You're facing Obamacare coming down in 2014. You have no idea what it's going to cost everybody. So you have to be careful what you're thinking about health care.
We are. As Steve was saying, we are thinking about the health care. We're thinking about the benefits. I'm not quite sure. Do you have a question for us? Well, I mean, we appreciate your comments. Do you have a question?
Well, just trying to express my feelings.
Okay.
That's fine.
We appreciate
that's the kind of public discourse
and as far
that
as,
we're looking for.
Excuse me, as far as meeting goes, some of the school board have invited parents to come to the meetings, and no one ever shows up. you know, this is terrible. The number of people that have kids in school who don't show up, it's crazy. They should be there. You know that. That's true.
I'm inclined to agree.
We agree.
Yeah. My mother had an old premise, and she said many years ago, more arithmetic and less gym. It was her idea of saying, do more book reading, education, and cut out the frivolity of all the sports games. I think you can start there by cutting some of that programs. I think it's going too far. Some parents are hoping to get their kids a scholarship for football, lacrosse, whatever it is. And that's fine. But it shouldn't be on the hands of the taxpayers to have to pay for that.
So. Thank you for your comments. We appreciate it.
Okay. Thank you.
Thank you.
Like
thank
it.
You.
That's exactly what we're looking for.
Okay. I'm Lee Andresmich. I live at 1179 Foster.
Okay.
We don't have to do that. Do we have 2 minute time limit? While I'm at the mic, how does these people feel about a 2 minute time limit? Are we gonna demolish the 2 minute time limit?
It was up to me. Well, actually the president of the school board has the right to extend time as needed.
The president? Are you gonna be the new president?
That'll be up to the rest of us.
It could be done.
Who's talked about the...
It depends on who doesn't want it.
I did. Okay. Transparency.
So Mrs. Gomez talked about kind of a town hall setting. I think what we could look at in terms of giving residents more opportunity is, having the current format with the committee meetings and the regular meetings and maybe sticking to Robert's rules and two-minute format there is fine, but I think having more more opportunities in additional to those meetings where it's kind of more of a town hall setting where residents can ask questions and the board answers. And
like the olden days.
And where residents can talk for minutes and express their views. I think kind of having there has to be structure and order and we can't have 10-hour meetings every single time there's a school board meeting. So, maintaining that kind of structure with some of the regular meetings so the business can be done, but also I think we all want to do more to try to engage not just community members, but Mr. McGurney talked about just all different interest groups or different different residents but from different backgrounds in different kind of formats as well.
Get the businesses involved too. I mean, the success to many communities is how they can attract businesses. And businesses like it whenever there's a strong sense of community. And I think this discord is causing some problems.
You think?
I really believe that if we involve the alumni, bring them back. Bring them back, talk to them. What do we do good? What can we fix? Bring the business leaders in. Talk to them. What do we need to do in our high school? If you own a business, what do you want? What are you looking for? Are we doing this right? Can we fix it? That's the type of discourse we need. That's the type of communication we believe in. Right now, there's nothing.
Okay, well, first of all, I'm sorry I was late. I was actually selling real estate. I don't know who you are.
My name is Steve Husser.
Okay. First of all, I'd like to tell you that you are talking to a 62-year-old resident of Bethel Park who is a graduate, who was a Bethette, who taught 35 years of school. I take issue with the man that just left because I did teach phys ed and also became a realtor. On top of that, I negotiated the contracts for the BPFT from 1984 on. So I have a little bit of experience. I came here tonight because I am tired of voting for board members who tell you one thing on one side and then get on the board and tell you a different. So that's why I'm here. So I have a list of questions, and I'll probably be dead by the time this all happens, but that's okay. First of all, I did hear
You don't mean you're gonna die before you're done asking the question.
Oh, no.
Okay.
No, you couldn't be that lucky. I'm sorry.
Somebody get the defib.
I'd like you to be, but you couldn't be that lucky. First of all, I'd like to ask a couple of things. How long have all of you been residents here? I know you, Pam.
I lived here from 1954 until 1968 when I enlisted in the Air Force. And then I had an interesting series of residences. I finally retired at age 59 and a half from all pursuits and ran back to Bethel Park.
Well, my son is in the Air Force, so I can understand that. How about you?
So I believe, this is because I'm 29 years old, and I believe I was two whenever I first moved to Bethel. It was 1986, and I went to college and was away, but
I get it.
Essentially, I've been a resident for 27 years.
My kids are 29.
August 2005.
Okay. And you would be a Mount Lebanon teacher?
Chartiersville.
Okay. I beat you. I've been here since 1951. So.
And you remember then when there really was, I wasn't kidding at the one school board meeting when I told them, Menzie Dairy actually had a dairy farm.
Yes.
Right about, no, we're not at the administration building, but right on.
Right there. Yes.
On Bethel Church.
You're right. Yes. Yes.
Very good.
I was little then, but I do remember. I also remember a time when, as Pam said, this district worked with the union. I got involved in the union because, to me, I never allowed any of my children, and I have three, to get in the gifted program because I felt that they should learn all experiences. And I got involved in the union because the government regulates the gifted, and they regulate the special ed. But the union contract regulates the average child. And that's why I got involved in the union. And we had very many times, which is why we have the contract we have, that we sat down with our administrators and we negotiated a contract. It wasn't hard. The union gives because we all have average students, or supposedly average students. And that's what the union contract protects, the average child. Otherwise, the school board would have 35 in a classroom and not 27. Otherwise, the administration would get rid of phys ed because we don't have any obese children in Bethel Park. So this is, I want to know also how all of you feel having administrators in our positions as superintendent and assistant superintendent that do not have doctorates on a quad A school. I want to know from each of you how you feel about that.
I personally have never been huge on degrees.
I understand
I've been huge on experience. I do have a bachelor's degree. I probably have the equivalent of a doctoral degree in aerospace engineering with some of the really cool stuff that I got a chance to work with.
Well, how do you feel about our administrators having no experience in the classroom? How do you feel about that, since your experience?
That's a concern. That's a big concern.
I didn't get to you yet.
Yeah, I would prefer, and again, hearkening back to experience versus education, I would prefer to see those who supervise have at least some track record in the classroom.
Our superintendent and assistant do not. How do you feel?
I concur. I think that that our administrators should have classroom experience, but in addition to that, they should also become aware of what's going on in the classrooms. And I don't think that that's going on either. I don't think that there's enough interaction. I think that there's a building on the hill, and I think the administrators stay there.
How about you?
Yeah, I would kind of agree with what Mr. Lau said about, I think just defining someone just by degree, I don't necessarily agree with that. I think there's a lot of factors that would go into being an outstanding superintendent, but I do absolutely agree with what Mrs. Doe has said of superintendents being engaged.
How do you feel about them not having experience in the classroom?
Yeah, I mean, I think that's, yeah, I kind of have to agree with Mrs. Douglas there and saying, that's something you want to have. I think they're going to understand the educational process. They're going to understand what teachers are going through on a daily basis in the educational process better.
How about you?
I just think it's important to get the best possible person in there. I mean, do they absolutely have to have experience in a classroom? I think it'd be great. I mean, I know my experience in a classroom, you know, what that brings to the table. But regardless of who they are, it's important to have the very best person. Are the
administrators and leaders of this district, are they the best we have? If they are, then I say retain them. But if they're not, let's look into it. Why not? We've had a track record of some issues since I got here in 2005. Is it the 30 years of the same, or?
No.
Okay, I don't know what the problem is.
No.
And can I add one final comment? She mentioned the building up on the hill. You know,
I'm used to 2 minutes, that's why I'm cutting you off, sorry.
Wouldn't it be great? We just built a beautiful new, almost $100,000, and everyone argues with me when I say $100,000. If you add all the add-ons, it comes up to about $100,000. Wouldn't it be great if we found a place for all those administrators in that new facility? And guess what? We could probably sell that building up on the hill, make some money.
Yes, lots of
you
money.
You want to list it?
I would, actually. I have another question for you. How do you feel about sending a lawyer into negotiations? As the experience I've had with negotiations, the best contracts we've had, and I don't mean all teacher acclimates, I mean settling without a strike, was the administrators and the team, having nothing to do with lawyers. How do you feel about lawyers coming into a room and us paying for lawyers instead of our school board to sit and negotiate?
Propriety forbids me from voicing precisely what I feel about attorneys. However, I will tell you that I filed a right-to-know request. You're welcome to come up and take a look at it. And I asked on that right-to-know request, if you take a look and see what I asked for, how much have we spent on the solicitor since essentially June of 2010. No specifics, says right on here. No detail, just $1 value. I'm gonna read you the response. Because as you know, right to know forms must be responded to in a timely fashion.
Who responded?
The right to know officer, which is Mr. Howard, and so I place no blame on him. That happens to be a duty he has. Dear Mr. DiLala, I'm writing in response to your right to know request, dated March 27th, 2013. According to Section 902 of the Right to Know Law, your request requires a comprehensive review. Now, let me go back on this. No details, just $1 value. But that requires a comprehensive review. Therefore, a response cannot be provided within 5 business days. We will respond within 30 days. So before
can
the
you
election,
publish that response?
It's right to.
No, I mean the 30-day response.
We haven't gotten
it. Yeah, I haven't got it. We're not there yet.
I know. I'm saying, can you publish that response?
Absolutely, because I'm going in under right to know. You know, under the Sunshine Act, it's going to be public knowledge, and I fully intend, again, in the spirit of transparency and letting the taxpayers know what they're getting for their dollars, I absolutely, positively intend to make it a campaign issue. Great. And to tell precisely how many dollars that we have fed into Maiello, Rungo, and Maiello. And I'm trying to not be profane. Let's just say that Chartiers Valley didn't like their services very much.
Quite a few number of school districts didn't like them.
But they have recently picked up Braddock.
Yeah.
To call them.
I don't want to cut you, but Pam, what do you think?
Yeah, we won't use any kind of language. I'll stop right there.
Well, I concur with you in the fact that the contracts that were settled over the years when I was teaching were settled when administrators and board members sat down with the teachers, not when there was a lawyer involved.
How do you feel about lawyers?
And I...
Paying lawyers to do our negotiations.
I absolutely think that the lawyer is a hindrance to the negotiation process, if not an obstacle.
I really have no experience with negotiations, so I can't really speak to the effectiveness or ineffectiveness. I mean, my sense is, I don't know that it's wrong to have a lawyer involved. I do agree with what's already been said, though, about...
Nobody's having, questioning involved. We're questioning in place of the
book. And that's about what I was going to say, is I don't think you can... the people that ultimately have the final say are the board members, and they need to be involved. You know, whether or not a lawyer is there with them or not, but the board, you know, if there's a lawyer, that's fine. The board members need to be there too.
Yours?
And that's, I mean, I've negotiated lots of contracts in my years in sales, and never would I put an attorney
in charge.
It has to be me. No, attorney would. I want him to look at the paperwork.
Okay. I only have two more questions. Okay. One question is technology. I went to the administration. I had my own technology. I had my own internet access. And every 10 minutes, my computer blanked off the internet. When I questioned people, I actually thought it was a sweep because I don't trust too many people up there. But it wasn't a sweep. Apparently, they interjected all the students that could have all of their iPads and all of their phones, but they didn't broaden something to accommodate that. And I'm sitting across the table from all the administrators who had all the iPads that I paid for staying connected to the internet, but I could not stay only but 10 minutes. How do you feel about that as a payer?
I'm commuter, yes.
Computer,
you can tell how illiterate
bit,
I am.
That's okay. I'm voting for you anyway.
I'm computer illiterate.
That's okay.
I wouldn't know a broadband from a thin band.
But your opinion as to whether or not they should accommodate everyone before they let everyone have it, what is that?
Well, I think it's absurd. You know, from what little I understand, please, I'm probably going to sound like a complete fool.
No, you don't.
But from what little I understand of computer networks, every time somebody logs on to that net or that broadband, I think it's called, that slows down everybody else's
computer. That's exactly right.
Is that how that works?
Okay, that's how it works.
I have a computer in my house.
That's
okay. A wireless
okay.
router and good old Verizon.
You probably have more than most your age.
1-800-VERIZON. That's all
that's
I have
right.
to know.
That's right.
It's broken. But more to your question, it seems to me that, again, we are in a technological age.
Yes.
And certainly to put in place a program that's going to blow teachers, our educators, people that are responsible for making sure that our kids leave the school smart as opposed to dumb, putting a program in place that blows the teachers off so that the kids can play who to what a puppets.
Well, I don't know that they're doing that, but they just didn't broadband their band to accommodate the students that they added to their band as well as the taxpayer. I don't think the students are playing games on their computers. I don't think that at all.
I would imagine that they got them locked out. But
yeah.
but my point is, I agree with you. You have to have a hierarchy of who can access the internet, and that's got to be teachers first, because if it's not, then the inmates are running the asylum. No?
Well, but I'm not a teacher. I'm a community member now, and so they can't accommodate me. So how do you feel about that?
Well, I'm not quite sure exactly what you're asking about, whether
there's a ban.
What I think is that the technological decisions that have been made have not been carefully planned out, and that the cart is going before the horse. Yes, the cart is going before the horse, and so we make these purchases, and then it's like, uh-oh, what did we do? Uh-oh, we've got to fix it. Uh-oh, we don't have this in order to accommodate it. So regarding the students' right to carry their own devices, it was a decision that I think more thought had to go into it.
It was
a knee-jerk decision in that not only more thought had to go into it, but the potential costs of instituting this weren't thought out carefully,
right,
is what I think.
Yeah, I don't know that I understand the setting in which you were there with students.
I was there in a meeting, administrators and myself, and public people, and
okay.
I had my own internet access.
Okay.
I just couldn't stay on the internet
because
the broadband wasn't expanded before they added everybody. My question to you is, how would you correct that for the average person that pays taxes and goes to the administration to a meeting?
Yeah, sure. I got to be just completely honest. I don't know that I know enough about the technology to know the answer to that question. I mean, I think I don't know the need to have internet access in the in during board meeting. I would want to make sure that what's going on in the classroom, that the technology that's needed for what teachers want to do in the classroom, that needs to be prioritized. I don't know enough about how to fix that. Let me explain why.
Sure. As again, I'm a realtor, so I had to get on my internet to make sure my house isn't. I could not do that at my own administration where I paid the taxes. That's why I think it needs to be addressed. How do you feel?
Well, last year when the decision was made to give students access, I raised a concern about that, and it was told that by doing this, we were going to save the district money. That's exactly what was said. Two meetings ago, when we were talking about this $250,000 purchase, up on the slide presentation, hidden within the slide, was the simple fact that they had already doubled their purchase of bandwidth from the AIU because the students had access and were sucking up all the bandwidth during lunchtime. So here we are. They made a decision, which whether the students can or cannot have access is one thing. One thing, they can't even control it. I mean, there's no way to control it anyways. But they already said it was going to save us money, and now it's already costing us money. And on top of that, they just mentioned in that same breath with that $40 million, they may need to hire a new person, a technologist, to help manage this student access. So what initially last summer, and I sat at that school board meeting, was going to save us taxpayers money is already costing us more. So what is the answer? I honestly don't
know. You'd look
know.
Into it. Huh? Will you look into it?
Absolutely.
Okay, here's my last question. And as a taxpayer, I want the answer to this from all four of you. I've already heard they're gonna raise our taxes. I've already heard that. I don't like it because as a realtor, I happen to know that this district is gonna get a 5% windfall from last year's tax bill. And Bethel Park was one of two districts that raised their school taxes last year. So that their 5% windfall would be higher this year than it would have been without the tax increase. A 5% windfall means that last year's total tax, they're allowed to take 5% more from that total tax in these new assessments. St. Clair, because they're getting their 5%, as Bethel Park will be getting, lowered their school taxes. They've done it already. What would you do in that situation, knowing full well that you are going to get a 5% windfall over what your tax bill was last year without raising taxes? Where do you stand on that?
Since I don't know what's on the table,
I'm going to read it. It's right here. The millage is actually going down 3%. Not going up, and there's no such thing as a windfall. There's a zero-based budgeting, period. There's no windfall. And it's zero-based budgeting. It was in, if you have a copy of the budget, it's
I did.
With the change of the assessments, the school district had to adjust so that they don't collect any more money
than 5% over last year's budget because St. Clair lowered their taxes. In real estate, I had to adjust every one of my houses for that. So I know that they are getting a 5% windfall.
It's against the law. You can't do it. It's against the law.
Well, actually, St. Clair and another district sued the state, and they can take any amount they want. Check into it. You'll find.
No, it's against the law.
So where do you stand on that? If, in fact, you get a 5% windfall, are you going to raise the taxes or leave them where they are?
Well, predicated on the estimated Mr. Spicuzza's comment, I'm afraid I'm going to have to leave that one for more study.
Till you get there.
Yeah, because I... Absolutely. No, not till I get there. I obviously, I have your point of view, and I have a sitting school director's point of view, and I respect both of your points of view, but now I don't know...
Which one?
Or is it somewhere in the middle?
Well, all I can tell you is I have no interest in it whatsoever, except whether or not you're going to hire my taxes. I'm not a sitting school board member, and I am a taxpayer. And in fact, I have adjusted all of my listings and all of my sales to accommodate the 5% windfall. So, and we were directed to do that by the county and the Whippeal, or the MLX exchange and our broker. So that's all I can tell you. I don't know where that's coming from.
At the preliminary board meeting, they did show how that they are adjusting the millage based on the new assessment system.
But are they raising it?
And the millage went down as a result, because you can only collect the same amount that you collected before.
Not true. You can collect 5% more.
The school district has already applied for the exemption to collect more money.
Well, St. Clair already took it to court. They already won it. And what they took to court was that they could only take 5%. They won that they could take as much as their assessments increased. Them and another district. Is it Char Valley? I'm not sure which other district it was. All I want to know is, if in fact you get to that school board and you find that you've got a 5% windfall, what are you going to do with my taxes? I'm not saying it's right or wrong. I'm just going to say, if you get there, what are you going to do with my taxes?
I'm going to be the best steward of your tax dollars that I can possibly be.
I'm loving you.
I'm going to be the second best steward of your tax dollars.
And you're going to be the third. You're going to be the fourth.
I can not to raise taxes, but I can't tell you what I'm going to do until I see the numbers. When I see the numbers, I will do whatever I can.
Let me tell you, people. St. Clair can put any house they want up on and for any price, and they sell it with 3 or 4 offers. Mm-hmm. It's harder and harder to sell Bethel's houses, and the reason is because of the strike. So if you cannot get on that board and make this better, there's no reason to get on the board, because it's hurting our values.
Thank you.
Thank you very much. You're up. And I think Mr. Sustich is on deck.
Now, I just was going to clarify. A preliminary budget is based on a zero increase, not 5% windfall. Will there be a windfall? That all depends on how many appeals are won or lost in the county. And you can't know that until you have a number. I understand your question, I think that's what you're asking, but I wouldn't expect them to answer, and I don't think anybody on the board.
I wasn't asking them to answer, I was just saying, if they find out they have a 5% windfall, are they going to lower my taxes? Yeah. That was my question.
That I don't know, but I can tell you the budget is a 0% increase adjusted by law. The law says you can keep 5%, Bethel Park's budget is a 0 increase budget.
And if you get a 5% windfall, will you lower my taxes?
Are you asking me as a resident or
as a board member?
Yeah, two different questions. But now, you ask me that when it gets here. Because I don't think we'll get anything after you deal with it. I think we'll still be here.
I don't know. You're going to.
Denise, did you say?
Denise.
Hi, Denise.
Hi, Denise.
Question. Act 1, you're talking about taxes. You're going to raise the taxes. You need to raise taxes. Act 1 limits how much you can raise in taxes. I know we've got exceptions. I know one's FEESRs, which is the retirement, because of how the fee is going up so high. I'm not sure if the other one's special ed or there's another. I can't remember from the meeting. How do you expect to get around Act 1? You're saying you're going to raise taxes. Act 1, I believe you have to vote. The community has to vote.
I think we said that in this day and age, with Pennsylvania cutting back and federal government cutting back the funds that they've been giving us, that money is difficult right now. It's hard to find money.
Yes.
It's very difficult. And that we will do whatever we can not to raise taxes, but we're not going to promise that they won't go up.
Well, I don't expect anyone to promise they're not going to raise taxes.
Right. I think that's what we said.
How do you feel about the general fund? I remember you were asked at the budget meeting how much was in there. Is it your plan as board members, if you get elected, you're going to read the general fund to supplement everything? At the board meeting, you asked how much. It was like 5.5 million or something.
I didn't.
The general fund.
No, I think I was asking the capital reserve fund.
Yeah, reserve. Sorry, that made it so wrong.
I just wanted to know how much was in there. There's about $5 million in there.
Because a lot of districts are pulling money from that, and a lot of other people think is a good idea, because you're just basically reading money that you can't replace. I mean, I go to meetings, sitting here listening to you want respect, you want to make the meetings,
Stewardship.
No, that's actually not the word. Adversarial. Mr. DeLillo and Mr. Majernik, the two of you at the board meetings have been very, very adversarial.
Yes, ma'am.
And very rude.
No, ma'am.
You've been very rude. Steve, I've never seen you be rude. You've been very polite all the time. Ms. Davis, I really haven't seen you at that meetings that many times that I've noticed you cause any problems. Mr. Majernik was at one meeting saying there were going to be 60 children in the classroom. And of course, Bethel Park Facts corrected that, and they said it was overly exaggerated. But these are the kind of things we're getting. And we want, I'm always asking for transparent negotiations, basically on the key points that everyone's fighting about. Because we have teachers going up to every meeting and telling, saying this. We have bus drivers doing the same thing, and then we find out that's not exactly true, what is being told. 60 kids in a classroom is not true, obviously. Any district, I don't think any district has.
Will you allow me to clarify that?
Sure.
One of the things that I heard, and again, this is just through the community, one of the things, the reason why they wanted to raise the classroom size was to prepare students better for college environment. In a college environment, they have large classroom sizes. Is that mm-hmm. true? Okay.
No, they do. I don't think that's the reason.
Okay, they do. So my fear would be if they uncap the classroom size, then they can automatically say, well, wait a minute, we have no classroom size. Why not prepare these students better? And this year's psychology class is going to be held in the auditorium. You see what I'm saying? That's my fear.
I honestly can't imagine any school district. Mount Lebanon and Upper St. Clair don't have school class size limits in their contract, and they're number one and number two.
But I want to make sure that they don't. Well, if it doesn't matter, why not just leave a cap?
What I'm hearing is that the reason they're trying to raise the class size or to remove that limit is because of the tight restriction where they have to add another teacher if there's more than a certain amount of children.
Correct.
Now, that's expensive. There's a lot of money spent on that each semester.
But I don't want my child in that. I don't want my kindergartner in that classroom of whatever that number might be, 31 or whatever that number
is. None of the classrooms have 31.
Huh?
I don't believe any classroom has 30.
No, I'm saying if they removed it, okay, if they removed it, and then the board decided, well, we got that one extra student. So instead of a classroom of 25, now it's 26 mm-hmm. or 20 or 21. I don't want my child in any classroom bigger than it has to be. The smaller, the better. The smaller, the better.
I mean, that's an ideal situation, unfortunately. I mean, my son did excellent in cyber school. It was a much smaller classroom. It was him and the teacher. He did excellent. It prepared him perfectly for college. I was worried about him going to college, thinking, he was an okay student. He didn't go excel. He didn't go out of his way for anything. Went to cyber school. He became a thinker. He did his work on his own. He's in college now. He's doing great. Positively great. And I pulled him out because of the teacher strikes. Now, the person was just here was saying about the attorney, and I know you're asking about the attorney fees, but you're specifically asking for a lump sum total?
Yep.
And you're gonna use that in your campaign?
Yes.
Okay, but that lump sum total also includes the assessments, appeals, grievances, unfair labor practices. I mean, that's
money
disingenuous.
It's not disingenuous. I have asked how much money has the school district of Bethel Park mm-hmm. put into the pockets of Maiello, Brungo, and Maiello? That's what I'm asking for.
Okay, but you're using it as a campaign item that they're wasting all this money on this attorney. If my question is, then why you have to get it broken down?
Why?
Because it's
so that I can get the same answer that the last guy got?
What was that?
We can't give you that information because embedded within all that detail are secret negotiations.
Well, that's the other thing, too. I mean, you were on the negotiating committee, weren't you, Mr. Davis?
Yes.
Okay. I'm not asking you for what's going on in negotiations. I can probably go to the board meetings and listen to the rumors. But I don't believe that the teachers union, I think we could probably get the school board to agree that negotiations would be open. And I don't mean that the whole community has to go to every negotiation session. But we've had 30 years of contracts, 6 strikes, and only one time when a contract was there no strike. just the one time?
I think it's
there's been a strike every time.
I think it's more than one time.
One time, there was one time, I think, believing the person that was just here was the union president. There was more than one strike in the same contract period, but it would have been. But the thing is, we don't have the same board for 30 years. We didn't have the same attorney for 30 years. The only thing in common we have is the same union for 30 years. So, I mean, why, what is the problem?
As I said before, I think we have a history of an adversarial relationship.
Right.
And that's what we would like to change. And that other districts can get it done. Why can't we? And so we think...
Well, I think other districts are afraid of being like Bethel. I mean, you're the one. We're number one for strikes. That's over 30 years. There's only one... We are number one in Pennsylvania for strikes. We're close. There's another one catching up with us. They're also AFT in Bucks County.
I'm not disagreeing with that point.
Yeah. Well, I mean, I'm just saying. I've gone to board meetings, like the committee meetings, and I've had teachers get up there and say, you know, we have students come here for our fields and for our sports. And I'm like, what? And then the next meeting, you'll see a family member complaining about, well, they spent all this money on that. And I'm like, well, yo, so-and-so was just here at the meeting saying he wanted all this stuff. We needed it for the school. I mean, it's like we get so much double talk. And like I said, there's a lot of rancor at the meetings, a lot of rudeness, and the two of you are actually the ones that have been doing the most of it. And I'm not exaggerating. Anyone can watch the videos. They're on Bethel Park website.
Why aren't they on our school website?
I have no clue, but I find them every week. I find them the next day.
I can't find them on the, I mean, I have to DVR it to find time to watch it.
Oh no, it's right on YouTube. Probably the same gentleman that's taping this meeting.
It's on YouTube?
Yeah. They're every meeting the school board is on YouTube. Every single meeting, and it's usually posted the next day. This one was a little late. But it's posted on the Bethel Park webpage. I mean, it's common, if you're gonna work on a computer, you just Google, you find them. There's every board meeting on video that they have on YouTube that you can go back and look at. But that's why I went back to about the 60 person in the classroom. I went back to double check, because I thought it was you that said it, and I wanted to make sure. But like there's just so much nastiness going on with the meetings. Some of the meetings, I'm afraid to be sitting in there. And it's not just the teachers' union, but the teachers and the family members that come up and forget to mention their family members, and they're asking for all this money because we need it. And, you know, we compare us to Upper St. Clair and Mount Lebanon. And the thing is, they don't have a lot. They're number one and number two. We keep slipping. And it's not because there's no contract. I really don't believe it's because there's no contract. Because how would that change the level of teaching?
I think there's a certain morale that has been lost.
Okay, but locking the kids out of school causes a morale problem with the students. And that's no problem, because there's studies saying there's no problem with that. I mean, I'm going nuts with this. And I'm scared to death. I mean, like I said, Steve, I have absolutely no problem. I probably would have voted for you as the fourth person. But unfortunately, because you're going in the block with the four, and the two of them have had so much anger and telling a school board president to stand up to be interrogated at a board meeting.
That's Robert's Rules of Order.
Yeah, but you know...
Was the only way to get him to talk to you. So I asked the gentlelady, precisely in accordance with Robert's Rules of Orders, would she stand for a brief interrogation?
And they tell you they don't answer questions, that they're there to, you know, they will respond, that in general they do respond. I've had them respond, I've seen them respond to other people.
I beg your pardon.
Can I?
You have public comments, yes. And you have board comments. You
right.
Do not necessarily have an intersection, okay, there's not necessarily a conjunction between the board comments and the public comments. Now, if you think I'm being rude.
I do. I honestly do, and a lot of people that have seen the video feel the same way.
I am being direct and demanding. And I'm sorry if that 41 years of negotiation experience comes up.
I'm sorry. The government bought toilet seats for millions of dollars. I mean,
sure,
that's not really a good...
I bought them.
I didn't say we did.
And talk to me after the meeting, and I'll tell you where the money went.
What one? For the toilet seats?
$1 million for the toilet seats. Do you think we really paid $1 million for the toilet seats?
I'm just saying, there's a lot of, I worked for the government for years, so there's a lot of waste. There's a lot of waste in government. There's a lot of waste everywhere. There's really not that much money, and we really don't have it. But like I said, Mr. Majernik and yourself have been very rude and very, and anyone can go back and look at any of the videos of the audit, the meetings, and it backs me up. I'm not exaggerating. I'm really not. Anyone that's seen it has said the same thing.
Very well. I would suggest to you then, if I sound rude, I'm sorry, but I'm going to be really direct. If indeed did you think my approach and Mr. Majernik's approach are rude, inconsiderate, or whatever adjective that you would like to use, and if you are completely satisfied that our teachers haven't had a contract for over 1,000 days, and that in the long run your property values are going to fall off precipitously, fine, don't vote for us. And I'm really serious when
I
say
that.
And
you know what? And it's not that the property values are going to drop for that. The property values drop for a lot of things. It's not just going to be for that.
Can I just say something about the nasties? I 100% agree with what you're saying. I am, I've been just very disappointed about the nastiness in general about this from all perspectives. There are people coming in. You know, I know Mr. Sustich, I think recently, in the last couple of months, someone approached him in the grocery store and called him a teacher. I mean, that kind of stuff is unacceptable, in my opinion. That's not how communities operate. There's been things, you know, at a recent meeting, there were some community members that said, the board hates teachers. That kind of stuff is not.
I feel like you're at a riot, the beginning of a riot at some of the meetings.
And I just, I don't think that Mr. Majernik and Mr. Galala, they haven't been the one making those comments. I think what Mr. Galala said about being direct, I think there's, you have to, there's going to be disagreement, and when you have debate and argument, there's going to be disagreement and direct statements, but it doesn't have to be nasty. And I just respectfully disagree that I don't think Mr. Majernik, Mr. Lilo have been the nasty ones. I think there has been nastiness from community members. I don't think these two gentlemen are I agree that they've been, I think, maybe more direct or more adversarial than
well, we're going for non-adversary.
Sure.
And you just said they were adversary.
Well,
so,
yeah.
I mean, that's what I mean. And I know the audience, I mean, I've been in the audience where I've heard people screaming, yelling in my ear, and I can't hear anything that's being said.
Yeah, and I mean, kind of.
And sadly, they're employees.
Going on the other side of this, I don't know what happens, in negotiations behind closed doors. I just think there's been comments publicly made by the board that I don't think are, this kind of comes back to, how to treat people and how to have effective negotiations where there's trust. There's been comments made at the board recently about how teachers shouldn't be in it for the money, and it was kind of said in a condescending way. And to me, that kind of represents disrespect, and that to me isn't how you talk to professionals. I mean, I don't think our teachers should, they're dedicated professionals, and I don't think that, they should be told in a condescending manner. It shouldn't be about the money. I don't think they should be accused of that just because they are advocating for themselves. I believe they have the right to advocate for themselves without being accused of just being in it for the money. And that to me, I don't think is very respectful. So that, I think, has been that.
The majority coming in have been asking about the money, and it's generally people who are at that $35,000 a year bump.
Yeah, but again,
which I understand, but it's like, that's a lot of money.
But just because they think they deserve a fair deal, does that mean that they should be kind of almost lectured and scolded in public at school board meetings? I mean, that's I guess what I'm saying, in terms of that it's kind of, it's on both sides. And I don't like that on either side. And that to me is a huge part of why I'm running, is I think this is such a great district in so many ways and for so many reasons, but we do have that reputation of just this contentiousness, and I, I,
And the strikes. I mean, we're number one for in the state or the country for the strikes.
And I just don't. I think our community's better than that. I hope to be a part of, not that we're not going to disagree in this argument, but of always being respectful in doing that.
So. And you have been. I've never, like I said, I've never, and others have noticed it too. But like I just can't. Unfortunately.
Thank you.
Good evening.
Good evening. My name's Tim Varley, and so that I'm not accused of hiding anything, my wife's a teacher.
We won't hold that against
her. Hey, no problem. And I want to respectfully disagree with the last comment that was made about the two of you at the meetings. I have been alternating with my wife going to the meetings, and I want someone who shows passion. What I don't want is someone sitting on the board telling me that we don't compete with Upper St. Clair or Mount Lebanon because we're not good enough. We're a South Allegheny or a Wilkinsburg. Put us in that category. Maybe rank us with a school district that's 52nd in education as opposed to someone who's in the top five, which at a meeting, possibly on YouTube, you can go back and see the school board member who did say that back to me. I don't want someone like that representing me. I want someone who cares about Bethel Park representing me. I want someone who can stand up and say no. Everything passes at a 9-0 vote. If there are eight sheep following someone, you can't tell me nine people agree on every single topic. Impossible. It doesn't happen. There's people that don't agree with me right now.
You should have been at some of our strategy meetings to see how difficult it was for us to get a 3-1 vote on this. Mrs. Dubos and I have, we haven't gone for each other's throat just yet, but and Steve and I have some pretty serious disagreements on precisely how to approach, and I give that to his more gentle nature and his youth. I'm old, crabby, crusty, and I've eaten a lot of excitement in my life. So if I do come across as rude, I insist on being direct, I'm being insistive, I'm being demanding. And I'm a taxpayer too, so I think I have a right to do that. So long as you're not profane or defame an individual, although I have taken some, I've asked some rather pointed questions regarding the solicitor and his role, and I think it's fair to say that with over 1,000 days without a resolution of a teacher's contract, I think his role, whatever it is, has been an abysmal failure. That aside, I'm going to stop there, because I mean, he probably knows how to sue me.
I appreciate
it. Comments or a question?
Mr. Return,
you hit the nail on the head. What I bring to the table, I never in my life ever imagined running for any type of political office. Honestly, I mean, I would much rather be coaching volleyball or soccer. Or that's where that's where I want to be. I'm doing this, and you said you have to know it's the passion. And if my passion comes across as being anger, I apologize to those board members who were present and not present. I don't mean to be disrespectful, but I am passionate about the children, and I am passionate about getting this resolved. I don't want my daughter to go through a strike next year. And I'm afraid that if we don't make a change, it's going to happen. And I think I can make a difference. So if my passion comes across as being angry, I apologize to those people. But it's who I am. And you have no idea how hard, maybe you do, how hard it is to get up and talk in front of people. This isn't what I enjoy doing. I get nervous. My ears turn red. I get, really, this isn't what I do every day. I mean, I do with kids. I'm the teacher. But that's different when you're talking in front of adults. But the passion is what I bring to the table, my experience, my sales experience, my background, my master's degree in education, my hard work. That's what I bring.
My first question, and I just have two, I'll be quick. My first question is, it was mentioned before, there's been a split in the community. If someone's approaching an administrator at a grocery store, or if a teacher is saying, or a parent is saying something to a teacher as they're picking up their child, how do we repair that relationship? How do we stop the hate websites that are out there by select individuals. How do we repair that?
I don't know if we can. I mean, I don't know. We can't wave a magic wand, and it's not going to go away right away. But we can start to take steps in that direction. And we have agreed among the four of us to try to reach out to all the parties if we become elected. Reach out and sit down and talk. And I think talking is the first step towards some sort of a understanding of walking in someone else's shoes, or you know, something along those lines. It's going to take a lot of time and a lot of effort because it's been going on for too long in this community. And I think we all four are dedicated to trying to get through that and to ease it and to create a better relationship with the community, with the teachers, with everybody.
And more evenings like this one. And it's not an empty promise. If we're elected, there are going to be town hall meetings. I can assure you at least two a year.
At least with the four of us.
And at least with the four of us. And I'm hoping that the other school directors, you know, the ones whose terms are not up, or, you know, if we're defeated, you know, by the incumbents, I'm hoping that they'll pick up on that thing of town hall meetings. To be perfectly honest with you, I'm not trying to unruffle feathers, but I know Mr. Spicuzza is very approachable. I know Ron Sustich is very approachable. Unless you're in a grocery store and you decide to berate him, and I can assure you that I think I said this in one of the school board meetings. It wasn't me, because there were three. Ron, do you agree? There were three or four people there in that meeting. It was Delala. He was gonna throw Stustich into the ice cream freezer. But obviously that didn't happen. Nor will it ever. Certain level of propriety. It has to take place. And civil discourse is crucial. This country was founded on it. And I really look forward, you know, not to come to the school board meetings and we'll give you 2 minutes and we'll cut your knees off. Come to the town hall meeting, speak for as long as you'd like, you know, we've got the auditorium all night long. Not a big deal. You know, and let's move on from there. But by taking that first step and opening the lines of communication, taking away, as they say in Spanish, the cono del silencio, if you remember old Maxwell Smart, the cone of silence, by taking that away and engaging directly. And hearing some comments that frankly we probably don't particularly like or agree with, but it's important that we get a good cross-section of the community, that their ideas, respond to them, and hopefully, as our four-year term cranks along, we can get out of this, you know, rancorous and divisive, mode that we seem to have been operating in for quite some time. And I hope that answers your question.
It does. My last question has to do with awareness. Great event, and I think the school board meetings are great events. This is not representative of everybody in Bethel Park. It's sad. School board meetings, same way. There might be 50, 60 people there. I coach a soccer team where parents assume that the contract has been settled between the bus drivers, between the teachers. They don't even know that it's still outstanding. We need to raise awareness. How can we get awareness out there so that there isn't an issue next time or an issue next year, where a strike is the only way people find out?
Let me field that one, because I think I've got an idea. You keep doing what you're doing, and tell 10 of your friends, and hopefully they'll talk to 2 or 3 of their friends. And if we're successful in our run for school board, you'll be talking to us. If we're not, you're going to be talking to Mr. Sessions. You're going to be talking to Mr. Spicuzza. And others. And I'm very, very hopeful that that happens. Again, I'm not running for a seat or for a title. I'm running because I'm moving in a specific direction to get out of that rancor and the infighting and the number one rating for school boards on strike, you know, in the Commonwealth. So, this is a start. But if everybody in here, you know, if you can get to 10 people and tell them, you know, well, yeah, geez, they talked to us and they didn't put a clock on us, and so on and so forth. They're willing to listen, and, you know, willing to have some civil discourse. I think that'll go a long way. Awareness is tough. You've been to school board meetings. How many of you have been to where there's 3, 5, or 6 people, and that's it?
If I can just add something to this, I mean, one thing that's really, you know, like I said before, I'm 29 years old, that's sad to me is the lack of involvement of young people. I think Mr. Majerian talked about, you know, and I understand, you know, that there's a lot of, you know, lot of demographics at Bethel Park, but there's a lot of young families here too. We have huge schools, there's families of children, and I think there's always a student government representative at, or not always, but there's a place for a student government representative at the meetings. You know, I mean, I would want to go into school and try to engage the kids in the schools about what's going on at school and encourage them to be engaged and tell their parents to get involved. I would want to, I think both Mrs. Douglas and Mrs. Ordinary talk about engaging, you know, businesses, local businesses. Like, go and talk to them and say, you know, trying to increase the partnerships in terms of getting, you know, students, involved in a job shadowing program and say, you know, come to the meetings and come to these discussions we have because you are important partners in the scheme. Really making an effort to go out and engage. You know, I certainly want to engage more, you know, get more young people involved in what's going on in their community. And I see that in my job when I work with a lot of, you know, AmeriCorps members that go and are getting high school, middle school kids engaged in their community. And when the kids see that people actually listen to them and want their input, that's where you get, then they say, you know what, this is worthwhile, this is something I want to do. And I think we need to make every effort to really proactively do that and say we are listening, we want your feedback, we want your opinion in any way that we can do that.
I think that when a school district goes into a defensive mode, they create like a turtle shell and they don't reach out. And so they're protecting themselves. So the school board's protected. And I think that's true of the teachers too. They're in a defensive mode. I think that as school board members, our job is to work to break down those barriers. And through that, I think awareness will occur.
Thank you.
I'm going to be quick because I know it's late. I just had to come back up here. Usually I leave. But I think a couple things were set up here that I think really need to be clarified. It hasn't just been the AFT that has been here for 30 years. I think if you do your homework, you will find that there are school board members that have been on for 30 years. And I think if you do your homework, you also find that before those school board members, there weren't strikes. And since those school board members, there were strikes. And the one time that there wasn't, the school board members weren't in the majority. And I think it's time to start saying that, and I'm saying it. And having been at the table negotiating since 1984, I can say that. Another thing I'd like to correct here, Pam, you were on the team for how many months before you retired?
2 years.
How many times did you see school board members at your negotiations table? Not behind the scenes, sitting across the table from you. We know we need 5 to settle. How many times have you seen even 1 or 2?
I never did.
Excuse me?
I never did.
Thank you. So yes, they might be willing to invite all the parents, but they don't have the nerve to sit down with the teachers. And that's what happened the one time that we settled the contract. They sat, 5 members
five board members who it takes to settle a contract in 1989 sat down with the team of which I was one, and we settled. That has not happened here for 3 years. You are paying a lawyer to do nothing. That's second. Thirdly, you want us to be number one or two? In 35 years that I've taught in Bethel Park, we tutored St. Clair kids and Mount Lebanon kids in math and science at the elementary. We don't do that anymore because we've chosen to take on a group of children, and it's a great group of children. I don't fault it at all. I love them. However, they're treated in standardized tests like the average student, which they need a paraprofessional to move from class to class. That's why we are where we are. Our curriculums are way, way above. And I speak from experience, a retired 35-year teacher. And I think it's time it needs set. Secondly, and my only third one, I want to remind you that we sent away all of our custodians in the 80s. We hired out for those custodians because it was going to be cheaper. Well, guess what? In the late 80s, we had to remodel all the schools because it wasn't, and we hired back all of our custodians. Now we're going to go out with the buses, and we're going to go out with this, and we're going to go out with that. We already have buses. What are we going to do with them? Trash them? That needs to be said. There's one more thing. You want to, it's negative, negative. It isn't negative with the teachers. You don't see the teachers getting up there and blasting the school board. No, you do not see the teachers.
Can you address the candidates instead of the members of the audience?
I'm not addressing all the candidate members. I'm addressing
the board.
Yes.
It's been like this. In 1995, we had a bad strike. In 1979, when some school board members just got on the board, we had a bad strike. It's respect. Respect on both sides. And if respect doesn't come from the board, the people in authority, it doesn't come back. It takes both. And you want your teacher to have respect because that teacher is in authority. In this situation, like it or not, the board is in authority. And when you look at that school board, you want to see smiles. When you four get on that school board and I sit in that audience, am I going to see you smiling or am I going to see you frowning? Because if I walk into that room and you're frowning, I know what I'm going to see. Disrespect. So you want this to get better? It has to start from the people in the front, and that's going to be you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
I'd like to make a little apologizing. Ms. Buckley is with us tonight as well. You're right behind this lady. I apologize, Cindy. Hi, how you doing?
Yeah.
This open forum tonight, you can respond honestly.
Hi, my name's Gary Reese. I'll keep it quick. Sound like a broken record from everybody else speaking, but I'm greatly concerned about the property values. And to think that this is this is helpful to property values to be naive. I heard somebody mention assessments. Well, when the property values go down and everybody appeals their assessments, they're going to win. So that's going to hurt our tax base. I just want to make that point, but the only question I have is, if you do become elected, what will be your instructions to the administration as far as negotiation with frequency? Because I don't know for sure, but I don't think it's very often right now. So what would be your instructions to them as far as frequency of getting a contract, which this obviously is, holding this district up?
My simple instruction is get it done.
Once a week, every day?
Well, some of that's predicated on when the mediator is available. So it's not always in the control of the two bargaining parties as to, how often. But I'd say let's find a time where we can all meet together a week straight and get it done.
And I
think it can be done. I think if you put enough time into it, face to face, it can be done.
And depending on whenever I'm available, again, I have a limited schedule, but
I would make sure that the public knows that we met. We met Tuesday night, we met Thursday evening, we met all day Saturday, we were there till 11, you know, that's what we would do. Has anyone here heard about when the last negotiation session took place? Really? I mean, no, I haven't.
Well, there's a letter, Tom, that was published that said that there have been, I believe, 55 negotiation sessions, and I'm not sure what the...
But we don't know when.
What the time period was,
but that's
but even that divided, you know, 55 divided into a, you know, into 1,000. I mean, I'm no math wizard, but that's, you know, that's pretty frequent negotiation sessions. And if we're meeting that frequently, but if we're meeting that frequently, and we're leaving it in the hands of an attorney who truly has no vested interest whatsoever in seeing a contract, because his billable hours go right if there's a contract. Okay.
And he doesn't live here, he doesn't have children.
Yeah.
He has no vested interest.
No vested interest in Bethel Park. I mean, if you think for 1 second that I gotta be careful in how I describe it. If you think for 1 second that the solicitor's firm has a true interest in the education of your children, I'm sorry, I would beg to disagree.
The question about the frequency of negotiations, I don't know that frequency is nearly as important as quality. If you have 10 negotiating sessions that make absolutely no progress, it doesn't really matter whether you have 10 or 1. So I think we need to, I think this point has been made several times tonight, but just we need to have meaningful discussions and face-to-face, so that to negotiate, it's not just we had another negotiating session, but no progress is being made. We need to have quality negotiating sessions, and I'm committed to doing, being there and being involved and trying to make progress all the time and getting this done as quickly as possible.
There's a negotiation
schedule
for
Wednesday
this week. It's right on
the school board. Thank you. If, we'll ask at the next meeting, but if you hear before we do, please make note of who from the school board, or better said, which school directors attend that session, or if it's just the attorney.
I
think
I
might
need to go, because I'd love to be.
I really kind of doubt that'll happen, to be honest with you. They'll probably invite me quicker, and my chances are somewhere between slim and none. And they told me Slim took the Amtrak for Harrisburg last night. So
before we end this tonight, I'd like to tell you about another Meet the Candidates with all of the candidates. All 9 candidates will be at a PTO meeting on May 13th, Monday evening at the high school. I'm not sure of the time right now.
It's 7 to 9.
Oh, Kelly could talk. She's running it, and it will be, we will have questions given to us ahead of time.
Yes, every Bethel Park parent will see something.
You want to stand up and yell there, Kelly? Project.
Should I come off the mic?
You're welcome to.
Sure.
The PTO Council, so all of the PTOs of all the schools, were sponsoring a Meet the Candidate forum. It'll have a different forum than this, though. We will ask the community to submit questions ahead of time so that the candidates can review them and we can make sure that the questions are fair and we hit a broad number of subjects, and each candidate will get to answer those questions. That'll be held Monday, May 13th from 7 to 9. We will be advertising through the school and on the school district's website, so hopefully everyone in the community will at least see the notice somewhere. I plan on putting it at the bank and the community center, so feel free to, my name and number will be on everything. Feel free to call me with any questions or concerns, and I'm handing the official invitation out to these members.
Thank you all very much for coming tonight.
Before we break here, I just want to say thank you for coming and being involved, and for being, I felt everyone came and taught. No one I felt was disrespectful to any of us, even if they disagreed with us. And I appreciate that. And I think that's, you know, hopefully the kind of dialogue that we can have in all circumstances. So thank you. And then I believe in terms of voting, the election is on, is on May 21st, Tuesday, May 21st. I believe the last day to register, if you aren't registered, is a week from today. I think it's Monday, April 22nd. So, and you have to be registered as either a Republican or a Democrat to vote for the school director. So, if you're not registered, you can obviously go get registered. But thank you.
Right, and we're all cross-filed, so you don't have to worry about running out. And if you really love us and changing your registration, you'll find us on either side. And I believe the incumbents you guys are all cross-registered as well. So it's going to be a fair and honest election. I have, contrary to what you might gather if you come to a school board district. School board meeting, I'm sorry. I have an abiding respect for school directors. They get paid nothing. They get a Excedrin headache number 15 every night. They have to listen to me every night. Although, Russ, I can tell you, I'm in Harrisburg on the 23rd and the 22nd. Oh, jeez. But Ron and Cindy are grinning. So.
But I just got to say one thing.
Sure.
I'm not up for re-election, so I'm just sitting here to enjoy the view, and I have no sweat.
Outstanding. And nor should you. And really, whoever that individual was that accosted you in the supermarket, that's the kind of people that you don't want living in the school district. That's the kind of people you keep out of the school district by keeping the standards high. So... Yes, ma'am.
One other point out of the conversation, besides being accosted in the grocery store, we get unsigned, threatening, nasty letters. We get rude, ignorant emails. So just for what it's worth, so you folks know what's coming. Good luck. Thank you.
Well, I've been down that road. And, when you're dealing with multi-million dollar contractual negotiations, particularly working with the folks at DARPA, everything is unfair, and you get put upon pretty good. I've actually traveled to Argentina under armed guard. So if you think you're getting nastiness when you're met at the CESA airport, with a guy with a bulb this big under his shoulder, you know things are just a little bit rancorous.
And we're all there for children. There should be no nastiness. That's my
bottom line. I agree with you. Directness, absolutely, all the time. Demanding demeanor, I don't think there's anything wrong with that. But taking shots at people, and I hope I haven't done that to any sitting school director. If I have, let me know, and I'll publicly apologize for it. Okay, and unless someone else has a final comment, I'm going to shut up and let Mrs. Dobos give her final comments.
Oh, no, I'm done, too.
Thank you all very much.
Thank you all.